Hi everyone, thanks for joining in. So happy to be here at the Lee Valley Tools store. And we're actually hosting a plant swap event. So a lot of activities happening in the back over there. At the same time, everyone's still shopping around at the store. But at the same time, I'm actually going to do a repotting basics demonstration for you today. So I'm gonna let everybody kind of stream in, give everyone some time to settle in. Again, so happy to be here again, and thank you for Lee Valley Tools for inviting me again to do this demonstration. So my name is Cheryl, and for those of you who don't know what I do, I'm actually a plant stylist, and I am very much active on Instagram. And on my Instagram account, I do a lot of repotting, plant refreshes, plant rehabs. I do plant styling and plant consultations. So basically anything that has to do with plants. And I get a lot of questions about repotting, which is why I'm going to dedicate some time to go over some of the repotting basics. So for today, because we have a plant swap event, I'm going to go over what to do once you've acquired a brand new plant as a trade. So what do you do? And just a couple of things to look out for as well. And I'm going to also repot this beautiful overgrown ficus ruby. It's definitely in need of a massive repot, so I'll show you what that looks like. And then at the end, I'm going to show you how I'm going to repot this marble pothos, because it's also very root bound, but at the same time I'll take some clippings so that I can get it prepared in terms of packaging in case you want to take cuttings to a next plant swap. So I'll demonstrate that as well. So thank you again for everybody streaming in. I'm going to get started with the first part of the live stream. And Big C on Twitch, I see you, so please behave. I'll leave it at that. So let's begin. So as I mentioned, we have a plant swap going on, and people have been bringing in potted plants, so something like this. It could be something that you've already have, but you're very happy to share with anybody else at the plant store. So you have a potted plant, and let's say you have this, it's yours to keep. The first thing that is recommended to do when you bring this home is, of course, check for pests. Everyone here is aware that they need to bring a pest-free plant to trade. Of course, there's always something that sneaks in, so always do your due diligence and check, double, triple check when you get home. So what I usually do is look through the back, especially behind the spine, where the petiole meets the leaf here. Usually some pests would kind of gather around here on top of the leaves as well. So just do a flip check and then, make sure there's nothing. What do pests look like? What to look out for? Fortunately, these guys don't have any. So what to look out for is some cobwebs, some white cottony masses. Those are some mealybugs. If you see any tiny, tiny little rice grains that are moving, those are thrips. Luckily, no thrips here. If you do see anything, it is best to remove them right away before you add them to your plant collection. So I'll quickly go through my go-to mixture, which is homemade. It's nothing too complicated. So I have here already made mix where I have insecticidal soap. So something that I like to use is Savers End All, which you can buy as a concentrate. So you can put a tablespoon in here with a tablespoon of rubbing alcohol and then fill up the rest with water. This is a 16-ounce bottle that you can get pretty much anywhere. And I like to give it a shake and just spritz it. Spritz, spritz, spritz. And make sure you get it all over the stems, leaves, under the leaves, over the leaves, and just leave it the way it is. Another soap, natural soap you can use is something like Bronner's Castile soap. And you can also buy that pretty much in any store around you. And they do help repel some of the pests. So this is what I do whenever I buy any new plant. So whether it's a plant, tree plant, if it's a nursery plant, if it's a, you know, plant from anywhere else, from your friend, your grandmother, your mom, always do your checks. So that's if you are bringing a potted plant home. At the plant trade, you'll also see many cuttings that may have already have roots like this. And luckily, the plant parent who has traded with you did an amazing job growing these before the plant trade. So we have some beautiful roots here already. How are we going to get this acclimated in your home? So this is actually pretty much ready to go and ready to be potted. So I actually have some, I think this is maybe like a 4x4 inch plastic pot right here. So if you've got beautiful cuttings like this, I would basically just repot it right away. So this is a mix that I will talk about later when I am repotting the ficus ruby. So what you do is just fill it up halfway and carefully add your rooted cuttings in here, and just make sure that all the roots are covered, and you just need to cover the rest here like that. And once everything has been potted, assuming you've checked for pests already, because that's by default what you'll be doing for any new plants that you bring home, and you just kind of set it down like that. I'm gonna need a little bit more here. Okay, and you've got yourself a brand new plant that you've traded with somebody. And you know, if you do, I would recommend watering it pretty much right away, because these roots just came out of water, so you want to keep that soil nice and moist. So this is actually from Lee Valley. I'm really happy about this tool. This is amazing. It's perfect for seedlings, because you can get a nice, let me put it right here, gentle little rainwater type watering for your plant. Let it drain. And of course, this pot has drainage, and I think this is also from Lee Valley Tools. And you want your plant to drain nice and free, like this. All right, so this is if you had your rooted plant treated and you brought it home. Another form of plant that you may have received from a plant cut, swap, is just bare root. This is no root, just a cutting from a mother plant. So what do you do when you bring this home? The best thing, and I know you might hurt a bit, but is to remove the last two. I'm gonna use a little pruner here, also from Lee Valley. I'm gonna cut the last two leaves like that. And these are, you can use it for decoration, but no longer required right now. But as long as you have two nodes here exposed, best thing to do is use a vial of water and plop it in there. Right now, I don't have enough water for the whole two nodes to be covered, but you just want to make sure that the two nodes that you just that you have right now is immersed in water, so that you can grow roots. And then you could do the same thing once the roots have grown in and pot it in a pot. So those are the three forms of plants that you may be taking home with you after a plant swap. So we'll see. I think the plant swap is currently happening. So if you are nearby in Vaughan, it's still happening till 4 p.m. And there's a lot of goodies, and a lot of people have walked away from the plant swap with new plants that they don't currently have. So super fun. All right. So next, I'm going to tackle this ficus ruby, which, you know what, this is in dire need of a repot, because I'll show you. All right, so this has never been repotted, and right now I feel like this is a good time to give it give it a repot, just because a couple of things. How do you know when you need to repot a plant? Because I know sometimes that is a grueling question. If roots are coming up from the bottom, and if, I don't know if you can see from up here, but if roots are protruding out of the pot as well, these are all signs that you need to refresh your soil, or it needs a bigger pot. So obviously this one, the roots are sort of outgrowing this pot right here. And luckily the plant is still pretty healthy. These are all new growth, but I feel like it would be much happier with a slightly larger pot size and a refresh on the soil itself. It's a little bit dry and you can tell that it's a little bit crumbly. It just needs something more to absorb the water. And yeah, I'll show you what I use in terms of the soil mix for this guy, because ficuses in general can be a little bit finicky. So let me gently remove this guy out of the pot without harming it. And you know, just be careful because ficuses in general are a little bit finicky, finicky. This is not a tinicky, it's a ruby, but it could be a little finicky in terms of watering, light, and all of that. So let me just take this out without trying to damage the roots. All right, so there's a little fabric here. So I'm going to do my best not to harm the roots, but at the same time, plants are very resilient. They will recover from any of the transplanting and repotting. So I'm going to remove this one. This was here just to cover the holes of the pot. There's some large holes there. So you don't want to mangle the roots too much, especially with a ficus, but I'm just going to loosen this up a little bit. It's another fabric right here. Of course, it's best to have a potting mat when you do this type of work because it can get a little bit messy. Oh, and I have gloves. I should have worn them, actually. I'll wear them when I put this in a new pot. So I'm just gonna gently massage this a little bit. Not too much. It's okay if you sort of let it be, but this is the extent to the massaging of the roots that I'm going to do. So I'm going to put this down here. And I'm going to quickly wear my gloves. All right, so in terms of pot size, I'm going with a pot size that's about 2 inches, a little bit bigger than what it currently is. I don't want to go too bigger than that because then ficuses in general do like to be a little bit snug in the pot. So just gradually going bigger is what's recommended for these types of plants. So I've already added a little bit of soil in here and I'm going to see what height this is in this pot. This is actually pretty good. I don't know if you can see. So I've actually added maybe a few inches of soil already. So I'm going to just fill her up with more soil. And I wanted to talk about the silhouette because as you can see, I have a bamboo stake here because it is leaning a little bit. So I'm going to try to make it a little bit more straight. So the root ball, I'm sort of manipulating it so that it's less crooked because before it was like this. Now I am moving it this way. Okay. And then what I'll do is I'll put the soil in here. And I just wanted to talk about the soil mix quickly. This is already pre-made, but I'll show you what amendments I have in here. So is this visible here? Lots of things going on. So if you can see here, I have a couple of amendments. So you start off with a potting mix. It could be peat base or coco coir base. It's up to you. Both are really good options. But I do like to add some coconut husk, some bark, some orchid bark, and some perlite, and of course some worm compost if your potting mix doesn't already come with fertilizer, and a lot of brands do have that. So all of these amendments are really, really good for aeration and creating air pockets in your pot so that when you do water, your plant isn't risking to be overwatered because, well, first of all, you have really good draining holes, and then you have a very chunky aerated soil mix that, you know, the roots have access to the water and oxygen as well. So you have less chance of getting root rot, which is one of the most common reasons why plants don't do so well. So all of these amendments are added to my soil mix, and that's what I'm going to use. And in terms of percentage, I'm not too picky. I do mostly half of it is the potting mix, and then a mixture of the next half with cocoa coir, coconut husk, bark, perlite, and some warm compost. So you'll see here what that mix looks like. And this mix works for so many plants. It's not just for the ficus, but I like to use it for pretty much all the plants that I own. So it's nice and chunky. You can tell that it's not dense. And when you do water it, you have all of these little pieces and chunks to help water drain and for the roots to get access to oxygen. So this is what I'll be using. And I'll just fill her up with this soil mixture, okay? So let's do that. If you have any questions about any of this, you can definitely add this to the chat, and I will get to those either at the end of the session, unless I like that. Can this be visible here? So you want to make sure that the roots at the top, the ones that were protruding out, are now covered, because you don't want those to dry out like it was before. So now I have this nice rich soil that is going to keep those roots hydrated. So now I feel like it looks a lot better. It's more straight, and I'm going to have a nice base here for the roots to get quenched. Okay, so this is now in a slightly bigger pot with a richer refresh soil mix. It already has organic fertilizers in there, so there's some compost in the soil mix already, and it's a nice aerated mix, so it's ready to go back home and keep growing. So yeah, looks good. And of course, this needs watering right away to make sure that the soil gets, all the air pockets kind of get compacted. So I'll put this back here. As I mentioned, any questions that you have, please put it in the chat box, and I'll have those answered at the end of the session. So next, I'm going to demonstrate a repot of the marble pothos. I really like this one because it's highly variegated. It's really beautiful speckles versus some of the other marble pothos that I've seen. And you'll see that there's some yellow leaves. I just wanted to show like real life plant ownership. Not all plants will look perfect all the time, and it's okay. This is a very healthy plant, but it will have yellow leaves. And most of the time, their bottom leaves, and they just discolor, assuming no pests or anything, or not overwatered, anything like that. They're usually the oldest leaves at the bottom, and what you can do is either leave it until it goes all yellow, or you can pluck it off and cut it off. It's up to you. It's not detrimental to the plant. Obviously, always check for pests, I always say, because you don't want that to be a reason why your plant looks a little bit off. So for this one, I don't think this has ever been repotted. So it's very, pretty root bound, I say. And I'm going to try to loosen the roots a little bit, but don't get too focused on loosening everything. This is too difficult to loosen up, but once it sits in a larger pot, eventually the roots will detangle on its own. Like, you don't have to detangle everything on your own. So I'm just gonna give it a little massage, but this is good enough. Okay, so in terms of pots, I'm using a slightly bigger one than this one. As you can see, it's maybe like 1 inch bigger. I wouldn't go anything bigger than that, just because these guys still really like being root bound anyway. So I'm going to just add a little bit more soil down here. Okay, and we'll add the plant And I think proportion wise, this is still fine. And I'm gonna add soil here. Okay. I'm gonna add more soil as well. I have it's really good to have a stash of pre-mixed soil. Okay. We have a question actually. Yes.
Yes, the question that we're getting is, how do you know when it's time to switch pots? Like, what are the things that they should be looking for?
Some signs is almost very similar to signs of a plant being root bound. So let's say, for example, this one, or at least a ficus tunica, when you lift your pot out of your decorative pot and you see roots peeking out from the bottom of the pot, that's a good sign that it may need a larger pot. Also, one thing that might also indicate that you need a bigger pot is you don't see any new growths for a while. And that could mean a couple of things, like fertilizing or, if it's root bound, but that could be a reason why if you haven't seen growth in a few months during growth season.
More questions. The next one is, can anyone with a black thumb do this?
Yes. I think everyone can grow a plant. It's just a matter of picking the right plant and also making sure that you have the right conditions. So that's why I do recommend, if you haven't already, just to take a look and explore my Instagram page as well, because I do provide a lot of tips. And many of it is geared to new plant parents, because sometimes it can be a little bit overwhelming, like where to begin. But something like this marble pothos is super easy, and it's you have to start somewhere, and it's okay to kill a plant. I still kill plants. It's not even killing plants, it's just not really knowing the right conditions or what the right plant was for you. There's always the right plant for somebody, so it's not impossible. I definitely encourage you to go buy a plant and just experiment.
Amazing. Is there a time of year that you think is the best time to repot your plants?
I know in Canada, because our winters are horrible, it might be a little bit scary to repot a plant when it's minus 20 outside and our humidity is down to 30%. But I've done it. I've repotted fiddle leaf figs, which are the worst plant to repot. So it really depends on your repotting, I guess, skills and methods too, because, I personally would say wait until spring. But if you absolutely need to repot your plant, let's say your plant fell off a shelf and it's completely demolished, you need to repot it, repot your plant. If it's healthy and it's growing and you see new growth, there's no rush to repot it right away. It really depends on the reason why you need to repot. I would say if your plant is dying and you see that your leaves are turning brown, and usually that's because of root rot or pests, let's say, I would do a whole check and then see if you need to repot. Like if your soil is infested with some pests or some sort of reason like that, for sure. Emergency, yes.
Awesome. We have one more question right now. I'm sure we'll have tons more later. Mm-hmm. But you mentioned a little bit, but can you elaborate a little on how to pick the size of pot for if you're repotting?
Yeah, so this is, I think it's a 5-inch maybe pot. I rarely go more than 1 to 2 inch in diameter. And the reason is that I think most plants actually like being very snug in terms of roots in a pot for healthy growth. But if you go too big, let's say your plant is swimming in this new soil that absorbs way more water than it did before, you can actually risk root rot, which you don't want that to happen. So it's better to go in small increments in size versus going from, let's say, 6-inch to a 12-inch like this, because then your plant proportionately is way too tiny and the root ball size is way too tiny for that pot and the amount of volume of soil it's sitting in. So it's just less risky to keep it smaller. Okay, so I wanted to show you also, and I don't think I need gloves for this one, because we're in a plant trade, plant swap event right now. Let's say somewhere else, there's another plant swap event that you wanted to go to, and you wanted to prepare your plant for a plant swap, and it's the day after, so you didn't have time to root your plant. You don't have, you know, the material, and you just want to go to a plant swap event. So what you can do is literally just take your plant, and I'm gonna cut, you know, right here, right above a node, just a cutting, and you can just bring a plant like this, and I'll show you how to wrap it up with moss so that you can preserve it for that plant swap event. So what I like to use is Ziploc bag. If you want to reuse any extra Ziploc bags or any plastic something, definitely this is the perfect little container to put your cuttings in. And what I have here is already pre-moistened sphagnum moss. And this is basically like a rooting medium. It's also used to make moss poles as well. So I will just show you what I do when I'm preparing this for a plant swap. So I'm gonna just clear this off a little bit right here. So I usually start off with a square, actually. So my scissors are right here. So this is a Ziploc bag, but you can start off with a square. There are tons of methods to do this. So this is just the way that I do it, and I get pretty good packaging for plant trades, even for shipping plants. If you've got a friend across the country in Canada and you want to trade, this is a really good way to package your plants too. So I put my wet damp moss and I put it in the middle here, and you can leave the cutting as is, or you can remove the bottom, you know, the bottom leaf here to expose the node, and you just wrap it up like a little present here and cover that node, and then you just wrap it up and just make sure that the node is completely covered like that, and you contain that moss. So what I do is I take some twine and then I just give it a little wrap like that and tie a little knot to keep it secure to contain that moisture. And if you need to re-moisten the moss, you can easily have this little opening and over the sink, just kind of like give it a squirt, and that water is gonna trickle back down inside here to keep that node nice and moist. I like to keep the nodes, exposed nodes, moist so that it doesn't dry out, because then you'll end up getting leaves that wilt, which you wanna keep it looking fresh when you trade. So this is a good way to go. And of course, you need to label, so you can use a tag to write the name of the plant, and of course your Instagram handle and your name, and then you just add it down here. And this is a really good way to bring a plant to a plant trade, a plant swap, or even to trade with somebody not in the same province as you, and you can ship this way. So this is very nice and simple. Is there any other questions? No questions? Okay, so if there's any other questions about the plant swap event, just a repotting of the ficus ruby, or even the marble pothos, please add them to the chat, or you could even reach me on my Instagram account at the Modern Monstera, and I'll be really happy to, you know, help you out, you know, share some tips. And of course, thank you again for Lee Valley Tools for inviting me. And I'm really excited because there's still a lot of people back there wanting to trade some plants. So thank you so much. Oh, and you have another question. Yes.
Yeah, we have a question from someone who's asking, how long in Canada can a banana plant actually live outside?
Outside?
Yeah.
I have never grown a banana plant outside, but I do know that it won't. I don't even know if it's perennial, but it won't survive like it would in California outdoors all through winter. Most of the time our zones are just really harsh for tropical plants. So any plants, unless it's a perennial, I would bring it inside the house and make sure it's protected from the harsh winters.
We have a question here actually from someone in the audience here. So I'm going to just pass over the mic here. You can introduce yourself if you'd like.
Hi, I'm Anjali. So I meant to ask this earlier and I just forgot. I have an oxalis who's not doing well.
Yes.
And he's either losing color. One, he's just not doing well. But then two, we're also losing color. Why?
Is it really close to like a bright window? I find that these guys are more happier a little bit away. I do have one at home as well, and it's at least like 2 to 3 feet away from a north-facing window. And I'd say it's really happy. Most of the time, if it's doing well, but the color's really faded, a lot of times it's just getting a lot of too much direct sun. So just try, like, experiment and take it away and see how it goes.
Awesome. And that was a question from someone who's here at the plant. Really exciting. We have a couple more questions. Someone's asking if you can elaborate a little bit on what a node is.
Yes. A node, do I have? Yes. So a node is basically a junction. It's basically anything where the stem and the petiole is separated. So this little V here, where it intersects, that's a node. It's simply as that. So whenever you are cutting anything, cutting plants or rooting anything, you want to make sure that you cut below a node. And then, of course, these are active auxiliary buds. These are where you're going to get roots. So you want to cut anything off that you will put in water, just not to have it rotting. But basically, that's as simple as it gets. Wherever you have that V and where it crosses is the node.
Amazing. Thank you. We have another question from someone who's here at the plant swap. So do you want to introduce yourself quickly and ask your question?
My name is Lily. Can you just repeat the mixture of the spray that you cured the plant before you planted?
Your spray that you were mentioning at the beginning in the bottle.
Oh, this one.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes. So in Canada, we don't have... There's a lot of chemicals that we're not allowed to use just because of there's a lot of pesticides that we cannot use as just a regular homeowner. Like, you need a license to use some of the So for plant parents like us, one of the more effective or helpful mixtures that I find works is a mixture of, so there's two options that I use, and I like to switch because I feel like bugs are smart and they get really used to one mixture. So you'll want to shock their system and switch it back and forth. So one of the mixture is Safer's Endol, and you can buy it at the local nursery, you know, Sheridan, Valleyview. Everybody has these little yellow bottles. You can use a tablespoon of that added in your 16-ounce bottle. I also like to add some rubbing alcohol because obviously diluted up to the 16-ounce because it helps kind of target some of the pests that's already there. So I like to spray this on, like, let's say a paper towel, and you use that paper towel to wipe the leaves down. And it's really good habit to do it regardless if you see pests or not, because you want this to be preventative, not reactive. So you want to wipe it down and wipe it under as well. And I know it could be tedious if you have a lot of plants, but it's something that you just kind of need to do if you don't want any pests. And then after you wipe it down, it's good to just give it a spray. And it's so diluted that I haven't seen, you know, any damages to my plants or anything like that. So once in a while, this is something that I would recommend doing when you're checking on your plants. Yeah.
Sorry, we have another question here. Yes.
Sure.
Can you also use it for outside plants?
Yeah. I mean, I would be a little bit more careful with outside because, you know, you don't want to hurt the bees and the butterflies and all the beneficial bugs. So I actually personally don't use them on the outside. I use my fingers to flick off Japanese beetles. So I would be just a little bit more precautious. It would be interesting to know what soap does to, you know, some beneficial bugs, but it's just a lot easier to use inside because there's no, you know, beneficials that are like inside your house. I think there are other methods that you would use for outdoors, like mechanical removal of bugs with like spray, hosing them with water for like aphids, let's say, but yeah, or BTK.
Two more questions.
Yeah.
One person is asking, do you personally prefer pink or purple potted plants?
Pink or purple? I don't actually have, the only pink plant I have is maybe my philodendron pink princess, but even then the variegation is like questionable. I would say pink. I love pink. Have you seen my plant studio? It's all pink. I would say pink all the way. Even in my outdoor garden, I have pink. But it really depends on the plant. I do love purple too.
Yeah, and we have a couple people who have been asking how to find out about events like this and where they happen and just maybe a little bit more about plant swaps and how people can find out.
Social media is your friend. For those of you who don't have social media, I think word of mouth is huge right now. Just connecting with fellow Instagrammers, fellow Facebook friends, you know, anybody who, like, I feel like Lee Valley does so many live streams. So if this is something you're interested in and you want to see more of it, like, reach out to the Lee Valley Tools team, reach out to me and say if you want more plant swap events, more live streams, what other topics like propagation or pest management, like this is the kind of communication and feedback that we need and we'll keep doing it.
That was our last question, but if anyone has any, really this is the last, anyone in the live audience here? Good? Amazing. But having a good time, so great. Yeah, so yeah. Wrap it up and let us know about, a little bit more about you and about today's event.
Yeah, so again, we're doing a plant swap event at the Lee Valley Tools Store. This is my first event, so I'm actually really happy about the turnout. Everyone's been super amazing and awesome and willing to share, like, care information. And I think experience is the best advice because you're talking to people who have grown these plants. So if you've got questions about that plant that you want, this is plant swaps are the best way to go. And I'm really, really excited, maybe hopefully, to do another plant swap event. And thanks again for Lee Valley Tools for inviting me and letting me use this space. It's been such a fun experience and I really enjoyed myself. So again, if you want to, you know, follow me on Instagram for more information, that is a really good platform to know what's going on around locally around here. So again, it's at themodernmonstera.com. At the Modern Monstera. If you have any questions, you can definitely email me at info@themodernmonstera.com. All right. Thanks, everyone. It was such a pleasure. Oh, bye.